Extended interview. Jewel Isabirye. Isabirye underscore 1, TK 14, 838, music in Uganda. Isabirye underscore 2, TK 45, 314, government and music. Isabirye underscore 3, TK 57, 507, traditional music. Isabirye underscore 4, TK 78, 140, edutainment. Isabirye underscore 5, TK 810, 518. Stigma and Philly Lutaaya. Isabirye underscore 6, TK 1213, 234. DJ Berry and socially responsible musicians. Isabirye underscore 7, TK 15, 159. Sex in Uganda. Isabirye underscore 8, TK 1618, 438, impact to Philly Lutaaya. Isabirye underscore 9, TK 1921, 504, the 1990s. Isabirye underscore 1, 1, OK, I'm Joel Isbury, I'm a Ugandan radio program director and also a nightclub DJ, a researcher at the Center for Basic Research in THATS Joel. Now, interestingly, in terms of an industry, I will look at the music within the context of the phases of our history. When we got independence, music was already an established industry. Before the colonial governments left. 2. There were set traditions that had been imported from their countries of origin. So you had a situation where some Englishmen established record labels here, trying to do a business that they were conversant with back home. And so eventually they realized if we sign local artists, we could perhaps market them to their public. So this industry became nurtured, it became associated with the other East African countries, because you had Uganda, Kenya and Tanzania within the East African community. Now after independence, there was some instability that took shape in the late 60s, and that disrupted the music industry completely. Now music still remained the source of pastime through the turbulent years. And it reached a point where even if there was no subsisting industry, music industry, the public attached itself to the few bands, the few records that were released at the time. Up till the point of the Liberation War in 1986 and afterwards when stability returned to Uganda, and artists who were burning with desire to establish careers, audiences that were yearning for local sounds that they had been deprived of were all of a sudden excited that there was some sort of revival. There was some sort of blossoming of the music industry in Uganda. So the late 80s and the early 90s are very useful to Ugandan music, because that is what the people remember most of the time. It's the period after the war, the time that they had to enjoy. So music has become a very important art form, because at this point people can go to dances, people can go to watch bands, people can go and watch artists. In the 70s and early 80s, you could not do that, because of the instability. Now within the songs themselves, within the music, we could look at the point of view of on the didactic role of the song within the public, or within Uganda as a community. What happened was, as some members of the community took up arms against the autocratic regimes of the day, some artists decided to resist by singing against the prevailing authority, but singing in metaphorical ways. Some artists, like Fred Masagasi, like Kusuf Sabeduka, would take the instance of a quarrel with the wife, a domestic quarrel, to transform it in the way the civilians would handle. 3. The new dictatorships. So at the time songs had double meanings, because artists had to preserve themselves, to survive. So the public was educated through the music, that was through the 70s and 80s, and those are very, very significant memories within the music industry in Uganda. Now currently as we speak, music still functions in terms of dealing with the current social, economic and political issues. There are people who have sung about the federal issue. Federal is THERES a kingdom in Uganda called Buganda, and Buganda was an autonomous kingdom before colonialism. And so, they crave to get back to that autonomy. And they have a term, federal, which is a coinage from the federal system. But it has become no federal with the no is the Uganda translation, but also signifies Buganda nationalism. So some artists, especially those from Uganda, to which the music industry is biased in Uganda simply because of the metropolitan structure of Kampala, being first of all the headquarters of colonial administration and so was one of the first regions to witness development. And so eventually the industries became situated there, and so forth. So because most of the artists either because they are from Uganda or because they come to Uganda to record, they are forced to sing in Luganda and also conceptualize issues that sometimes relate to Uganda. So Federal has become a very significant, or the song has become a very significant channel. Another area where the song became very important beyond the domestic situation or the gender relationships, which is also related to gender, is the fight against AIDS, or what we would call advocacy, for instance, or what we would call the social response to calamity, because in Africa, in Uganda, not only in Uganda but in different parts of Africa, unlike in America or in Europe, where it's usually the country musicians who deal with such issues, whereas the pop musicians will have a romantic approach. Romantic is in the point of expressing sensual feelings and so forth. Here. 4. Music is used to communicate even the birth of a child, the presence of a calamity. So what happens is when AIDS appeared in Uganda in the early 80s, some musicians initially sang about AIDS being brought by the liberation forces that came from Tanzania. Some musicians looked at AIDS as being some other form of colonial power, some conquering force that had come to capture. So there were all sorts of physical and metaphysical explanations of this crisis through song. And slowly as time went by, different artists handled this calamity, helped the population cope. The government used music as a means of educating the masses. The government used musical drama, which is very significant to the industry, because a certain genre called Kitumba musicum, which used to be got out of the plays, scenes from the plays, eventually became recorded, and some of these dealt with issues like AIDS, issues such as environmental protection and so forth. So music became very significant in terms of an attachment to memory, to a very significant way of configuring or imagined community as Uganda. It also became very useful in dealing with the social, economic and political issues of the day. Throughout time up to this time, music has continued to play that role. Isabirye_2. In the past, I'm going into independence and post-independence, because I have understood our history from three perspectives: pre-colonial, colonial and post-colonial. Shortly after independence, the governments in Africa felt it one way of fostering autonomy or fostering independent culture or the independent characteristics of their countries was to look to the arts and preserve the traditional arts or traditional culture. Now what happened was some governments started sponsoring bands. Sponsored bands. The Afrigo band that 5. We see today was an offshoot of the Cranes band, which was under State House funding during IDAMINS period. Used to move with these bands to show the rest of the world what Uganda had as a way of expressing her heritage, so he said. After that point, after the wars, the Abati period and when the Naren government came to power, they did not sponsor commercial bands. They only sponsored bands that they thought were useful in particular campaigns that the government was interested in. So when AIDS had come, or when AIDS was really, it's still a problem, but when it was a surprise, THHS in the early 90s, the government sponsored drama competitions that were called Hydro Productions. AIDS was seen as in comparison to a hydro. So within these drama competitions, music was produced as well. So music groups could showcase, but these had to be amateur groups. The government hardly sponsored commercial groups. They only used organized groups of people in villages, in towns, in schools, that form choirs and then give them funding to support the campaign against certain causes. Now incidentally, these people usually do not exist for long as a music group. They are just mobilized for a particular cause, and then trained and then they do either recordings or they do live performances in villages and so forth. The commercial bands have always existed on their own apart from the main regime, but still they also at certain points in time, come together and look at certain national causes that they think they will perhaps sing about. Asterskaya sabiry underscore c at the point of 6. Informal education. Before formal education came to Uganda through religion and so forth, music was used as a form of entertainment but also a means of educating. So singers and their troops were actually people who played with a particular message relating to a specific context within the community that they came from or they performed to. In some places, on Bibi for instance, in the king's court, some societies had kings, like Uganda. There were specific musicians within the king's court. 1. They portrayed the regality. They portrayed the royalty of the king, the customs, the traditions of the kingdom. THATS what they sang about. From the time Chinta formed Uganda, this is what happened. A woman always had to kneel before a man. Dada, things like that. So, they tried to preserve the customs through song, and because music was a form of entertainment, something people would memorize, it became easier to educate the people through the music that was performed by these troops and individuals. The crucial role that music played was to educate through entertainment. That is where the quest for traditional music became very strong, because people thought that if music that came from out over to what was from here, then even the values through the lyrics, through the themes, would be transformed into values from abroad. So eventually, custodians of society or custodians of social order felt that music that came from abroad, there was need for some sort of regulation. The traditional music had to be promoted. Music had to be used in different types of ceremonies to signify the birth of a child, to signify circumcision, to signify a marriage. An artist would compose a song to help the couple handle this new task of marriage that they have gone into. So music was used, I would say it was functional. I would say it would be context-oriented. It would depend on the particular intention of a given composer, but the overriding issue then was that music had to educate through entertainment. 7. And up to now, the artists do not just perform to perform. Normally the songs that eventually become hits in Uganda, apart from having the perfect melody, the perfect hooks and so forth, there has to be some context-related message, whether it's good or bad. For instance, now artists sing about Kizunja. Okay, Kizunja is a term, it's the current president wants another term in office, and term in Uganda is Kizunja. So artists sing about Kizunja in relationships, asking the loved one, okay, give me a Kizunja. Then the other one says, no, it's enough. So actually what they're dealing with is a political issue, but allegorical. So music primarily was for edutainment, but through that, there was some transmission of culture, there was some preservation of culture, there was some preservation of memory, all through the song, and up to now. And by the way, the situation in urban areas is very deceptive, because the music, the traditional music is still prevalent in the rural areas. People don't record. They still sing these songs while they're doing their farm work. They sing songs that will motivate themselves. I dig every day to send my kids to school, da-da-da. That song makes the tga go on and on. It's in the villages, it's still very much prevalent. Music THATS not recorded, but music that is rich with messages that are significant to the current context of the particular singer. Asterskaya sabiry underscore 4. I think I'm one, I will not overgeneralize it as human nature. Loving music and so? I would think as a form of entertainment, some attachment that the public has to it. If you, for instance, did an anti-colour campaign, 8, using music, or using film, YOUD have almost the same effect, because both are media of entertainment. I think I still believe that it becomes a very, very, very significant channel, because it is a media that people derive pleasure from. It's a form of entertainment that people derive pleasure from. THATS what makes it? It's like giving a young child a quinine tablet within a sweet. It becomes easier for the child to enjoy the sweet while taking in the quinine tablet. So I think because music is a form of entertainment, and people have this strong attachment to it, it becomes very significant as a channel. Asterskaya sabiry underscore 5. No, it's good why all your V mentioned the stigmatization, because CHAT is one of the issues now the government is concerned with. Right now, awareness about HIV/AIDS is pretty much everywhere. So the government thinks. The issue now is how do the AIDS or HIV/AIDS patients live within society? How do you preserve this labour force that will perhaps be very relevant for as many as is possible? 1. Try to deal with the stigmatization, because if they feel at home in their communities, then perhaps they will not worry too much. Now, in Uganda, some artists like Richard Kawisa have used song to inform the public that AIDS has no barriers, okay, has no socio-economic barriers, or political barriers, it could get anyone but still anyone can prevent it. Now, the significance there is of them. Whereas you would look at this patient today as an AIDS victim, look at the possibility of yourself. 9. The next day. Fine, that is Kawisa and friends. But before all these musicians came up, there was Philly Lutaaya, and Philly Lutaaya gave, if I am right to say, a human face to living with AIDS. He made it seem as if it was not a monstrous thing. He made it seem as if I mean as an icon, as a social icon, he was immune to problems that say someone in the village could have. But here he was, HIV positive. He used it to educate the public about himself and also the public about stigmatization. So from that point, I would say music became effective from Philly Lutaaya in Uganda in dealing with stigmatization. Several artists took up the initiative to sing about people living with AIDS and the significance of society staying with these people, welcoming these people, dealing with these people, because they were people like anyone else. So various artists have done that, but I think the landmark, the most significant moment started with Philly Lutaaya, and that is when music became very significant in dealing with stigmatization in Uganda, because initially, it was hard to demystify AIDS. Many people thought it was witchcraft. Many people thought it was only the sexually immoral, and so if you said you had AIDS, everyone would say, ooh, he slept with the whole village, ooh, he slept with the whole town. But through song, some artists, as he mentioned Richard Kawisa, Livingstone Kasati, Prince Dugo, all these artists dealt with AIDS in a way that would help AIDS patients deal with stigmatization or would coerce is a strong word, or would get society to recognize that AIDS and the people living with AIDS were like anyone else. WHO do have that problem. So I think in Uganda, music has been very significant because 10. In the stages of the campaign against AIDS, we are currently on the stage against stigmatization, and some artists who sung, expressed themselves in their songs and managed to pass across the message to their audiences that AIDS, the people living with AIDS, are like anyone else, and it was very important for us to treat them like we would want to be treated. For instance, if we had AIDS. So our music has been very vital, but I think it would not have been as vital as it is without its landmark of Philly Lutaaya. *KSABIRY_6/12. Perhaps before we go any further, I do not know whether YOUVE come across the name DJ Berry. Okay, DJ Berry was one of the first superstar DJs in Kampala. He died of AIDS in 97. Berry contracted AIDS in 1988. He lived in Kampala. He was a star. I mean, he had lots of money. Latest records. He basically was everything. Then he found out, after his girlfriend died, that he had AIDS. He was the first rapper in Uganda. He released records. At that point in time, Berry also took a stand in the footsteps of Philly Lutaaya. He also took a stand that was very significant to the youth, because the youth looked up to Berry. The youth looked up to Berry as some kind of entertainment god, okay. So he was very significant at that point as a role model. He released a song called, Beware, AIDS is Coming. Very significant. Don't be like me, you could die. So he was very, very significant. Unfortunately, because he was in the footsteps of Philly Lutaaya, his activities perhaps were not so publicized. He was doing what people were already used to, but he had a very, very great impact. So as far as this miseducation is concerned, I believe it's up to civil society, it's up to the government, it's up to socially responsible masses. 13, tune to them. 2, to aspire, to pass the rightful message across. The only problem is you cannot force them to do it. It takes a lot. It takes a lot of personal experience. It takes a lot of experiences by relatives. It takes a lot of relationships for artists to really think about such issues. *KSABIRY_7, 15. One thing is, currently, sexism. Let me put it this way. Before what you said, the crisis of AIDS and the survival, I mean promiscuity was there, okay. But it was not spoken about. It was actually taboo. It was not good for someone to stand up, say a parent to talk to their child about sex and so forth. Now, when AIDS came, people realized that from this pleasure you could actually get pain, and the anti-AIDS campaigners used sex. They pinpointed sex as the sole cause of AIDS. They looked at it as one of the ways society would help, or rather society would cope with the problem, by abstaining or using condoms. I would say, it's still, the rampancy or the promiscuity is still there, but people move towards safer sex than just sex. I would not say, now Ugandans all are holy than thou. No, no, no. It's still there, but zero grazing. I mean sticking to one partner, or using condoms, or abstaining. Yeah, but it's still there. Asterisk. *ISABIRY_8, 16. 1. Being a passionate or being someone with a passion for music. I think losing the icons first of all was very, very significant, because my attachment to music is such that I am also attached to the artist, and losing Silly was very devastating. Asterisk actually when he announced at my career university in April 1989 that he had AIDS, everyone said, he wants to capitalize on the funding from the United Nations, World Health Organization. Oh Silly, his fortunes are going down as a musician, he's trying to make some money. Then Silly became frail, Silly became frail. Then other people started saying no, actually we know his neighbors at home are actually bewitching him. His dad used to quarrel a lot with him, they had a fight over land, so why are you bewitching the son? Until Silly sang Alone. When he released Alone, and then the documentary after that, what changed impressions? It was very, very devastating because one person we felt would have become like Phil, international. One person, actually, why he won Lifetime Achievement Award this year. Someone we felt, for contemporary Ugandan music. A father figure. What I would say. Asterisk. 17. Philly used to say, when he was with close friends, be very careful, be very careful, you, girls destroy you. He would not say it in public. He said girls would destroy you, which would be negative, because that would be blooming. Laughs. One party without looking at the other side. So eventually then I lost a number of uncles as well, who were extremely wealthy. And I thought there was no way they would pass away with all their wealth. No, no, no. I realized that this could actually affect everyone, such that even in a relationship, you always think of that. Even when you're starting a relationship, it's at the back of your mind. Even when people are getting married in Uganda, by the way, the churches, it's mandatory, you must have an AIDS test. You see, the churches say, we must know whether you can. I've had situations where people are not wedded, because they refuse to have. 18. The test, because they say, well, if you're going to let it be known in church, already you're going to stigmatize us, you see. So it's very serious here, because people have lost, even people in the church. Some bishops and pastors have been lost to AIDS. So it's basically, out of my experiences, I look at it as something part of me, but I can still protect myself against. I look at it, it's like bad weather and then I buy an umbrella for bad weather. How I look at it. It's exclusive. Think it belongs to someone else. I think it's part of my society. It could affect me any time. and listen to this carefully. It has also helped me mentally prepare in case it occurred to me. The experiences and dealing with those who had it helped me prepare in case it happened to me. I don't want it to happen to me. I'll make sure it doesn't happen, but in case it does, this is how I would handle it. Here. *ASABIRY_9/19. It was terrible. I mean, it reached a point where I thought if you went out of the house, why oh you'd get AIDS. It reached a point where even they started saying, oh, some flies in southern food and are the first insects to transmit AIDS. Panic. People were very scared, and by the time, the deaths, 20, I mean people, I think people die these days of AIDS, but not like they used to, in terms of the suffering, the extent. Right now you could really suppress the symptoms, but at that time, it was terrible. Why oh you'd go into hospitals and find? Actually, there was a word, a special word, I don't know whether it's still there, called 4C, in Malago. You heard about it? It's still there. It became a term, I mean someone would come back to school the next term and say, oh, my dad died. You say, what happened? He says, 4C. 4C. So it became both mental, some sort of mental persecution for us living here. I really knew it was around, I really knew it was a problem. But when it came closer, and members of my family, my uncles, started passing away. THATS when it went off the roof. It was terrible. But one thing I'm grateful for is, somehow, and I'm thankful to the government. The government rose against the epidemic. Some African governments did not rise. Kenya for one kept quiet. They did not want to scare tourists. They kept quiet and said no, THATS not here. Uganda made noise, and it has helped us where we are. Take us to where we are. Kenya has just started under the current regime which came in 2002 to actually face the epidemic. It was really a problem. There were massive deaths. I mean you could find a situation where a whole village would go. Rukai, for instance. Heard of Rukai. Rukai was the first district. THATS why they say it came from Tanzania. Yeah, because it's close to the Tanzanian border. So they thought the soldiers that came to overthrow Amin actually brought it. Towns were wiped out of existence. Kids and grandparents were the only ones there, you see. So illiteracy levels went up. Kids had to drop out of school. Kids could not go to school, you see. No one to teach them, that kind of thing. *2-1 it reached a point where I thought I would not get married because of what was happening at the time. It was a very huge risk. So I thought, but music has helped the people hope, has helped the people cope. Where there is no hope, THEYVE coped. And THATS how it is. The Afrigo band lost about 7 members. One of the greatest musicians of all time, Tony Sengo, passed away and that was more shocking for me than Lutaaya, because he tutored me when I was in my 4th form vacation. I worked with him in a band, and now basically all the artists you see now passed through him. He passed away. And within the band, everyone had slept with each other, and the whole band went away, the big 5 band apart from 2 members. So it was really really scary for me. It was really scary. And I always felt, music, THATS where the ladies are, and that is a very big risk. No. It reached a point even when I used to be a radio DJ on air, I would make sure my conversations with listeners would not go beyond hi, what can I do for you, da-da-da, and then I get off, laughs. Yeah, so it has been an experience, but it has reached a state where people can now cope if there is no hope.